Easter.
Happy Easter.
Happy. This is the day the Lord has made. We will
rejoice and be glad in it.
Let's do that a little louder, because today we celebrate our risen Savior. He rose from the tomb to give us eternal life. This is the day the Lord has made. We will
rejoice and be glad in it.
That's better. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you, dear Lord, that you give us eternal life through your Son, Jesus Christ. We can never thank you enough. Help us to serve your purpose for us on this earth, dear Lord. And we just thank you and thank you and be with us. This is all about you, dear Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you'd still be seated.
Crown him with many crowns. We'll see how weak everybody is tomorrow.
Yeah.
This is the day the Lord has made. We'll rejoice in
it. Be glad in it.
Nah, I'm going to do it twice. One more time? Okay, this is the day the Lord has made. We'll rejoice in
Be glad in it.
Why can't you just to give me a hard time? Our God is good, amen. I'm excited to be in fellowship today.
Amen.
Oh, we got a couple. Okay, we got a couple. We got a few, almost a majority. I'm pretty excited. Today it's like, I shared with somebody this morning, I said, you know, I was still celebrating Christmas and then realized it's April already. And that's always a sign of age when we talk about age. But I remember as a kid, the dad never listened to. I mean, he had one of those. Everybody had, they weren't smarter back when you were a kid, that's right. And don't grow up too fast because when you get up, I'm like, yeah, you don't know what you're talking about. Now I'm like 824. And I'm like, where'd the time go? Man, the time flew by. But you know, we got a great expectation. You know, the exciting thing about being in Christ, Christ being in you, is that guess what? It's not going to stop. It's just the beginning. If you know Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior, life is just the beginning. And that's the exciting part. You know, Resurrection Sunday it just gives us our basic foundation. And that's your excitement. That's your excitement. We believe in a risen Savior. Amen? But there's some people that don't believe. There are some people there that experienced it live. You know, not memorized, but live, that did not believe. But what keeps us going is we know we have a Savior that's alive. We don't serve a dead Savior. He's alive. He's left and right. He did all those things for us. That's humbling. That should be humbling. Because most of us can think of a million things why we don't deserve grace. We could. But not for God's grace, many of us would not be here today. If not for God's grace, you wouldn't be here today. There's no mistakes. That's what I love about Jesus. No mistakes. You might think you're a mistake. We make mistakes, but Jesus makes no mistakes. You're always here for a reason. And Paul, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we're going to start reading verse 1 through 11, but Paul kind of did a court setting. He's kind of wondering, how can I know for sure? First off, look around you. If there's anyone here that believes in Jesus Christ, they will tell you stories about their life that Jesus brought them through, that took them from a dead existence to a living existence, in a heartbeat. That's witness enough. But I started thinking about this. Witness for the defense. We always are on the defense most of the time. Why should I believe in Jesus? Why should I believe in Jesus? Well, that opens up doors, doesn't it? Let me tell you why. Let me tell you the hope that is in me. Let me share these things. Sometimes when people get you started, they're kind of like, I wish I would have done that. Especially me. Hey, let me tell you. And I'm going to start back in 1954 when I was born in Rome, Michigan. Go through the whole scenario. But there are witnesses. There's witnesses. You can't convict without a witness. You can't go on hearsay. You can't go on a letter. You can't go on those things. It takes a witness. So the judge was to put Jesus on trial. So how can we know for sure that you rose from the dead? That you the stones rolled away. People saw. There's witnesses. Now, any court in the world, if a defense attorney started calling witnesses and said, wait a minute, I have 499 more. Okay, the judge is going to say, I'm going to throw this out. If you've got that many witnesses just alone, it's enough to believe. That's what Paul did in the Corinthian church. There were some people denying, some people weren't sure, some people struggling. And Paul said in verse 1, chapter 15, he said, now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, by which you are being saved if you hold fast to the word that I preached to you, unless you believe in vain. For I deliver to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sin in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. And then he appeared, to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as one untimely born, he appeared to me also. For I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by grace of God, by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any one of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that was in me. Whether then it was I or they, we preach, so you believe. Father, we just come before you, Lord, and thank you for your word. Father, salvation is in your word, through your word. Because, Father, there are many witnesses. There are many people that will stand up in a heartbeat, Lord, and share what you've done in their life. Share the experiences they had with you, intimately, personally. Father, that you stood on your word, you never leave us nor forsake us, you're never alone. Father, people struggle. People go through things. Even us of faith sometimes hit spots, Lord, where we just have to be reminded of whose we are. Father, this day that we celebrate, so excitedly, Lord, it sometimes goes by the wayside after it's passed. Father, should inspire us to give us those things to live by. We serve a risen Savior as Jesus Christ came. Father, we thank you for this thing. In Christ's name, amen. One thing I like about Paul when he wrote this, he didn't just stop and use his life as an example, did he? You know, he didn't come to the forefront. He said, I delivered to you the most important thing. Jesus Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture. He first appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. And then he appeared to more than 500 people. Now, Paul is saying that for a reason. Because you can't refute the evidence. You can't go against the witnesses, amen? You're going against 500 transformed lives. And it's just like in the body of Christ. You know, if somebody comes into the church or into the body of Christ, and you're not excited because you're saved, you have a relationship with God, why couldn't you come back? Amen? Because guess what? You're still acting like a dead man or a dead woman, however you want to put that. We've been made alive in Christ. The Scripture says we've been quickened in the Spirit. That means made alive in Jesus Christ. Without Jesus Christ in our lives, we wouldn't be who we are to this day. Now, are we perfect? Am I got one no? Oh. Let me go to Proverbs where it talks about pride, you know. The thing about it is coming to a place in your relationship with Jesus Christ and being grateful and realizing that, wow, dead doesn't raise the dead. Amen? Alive raises the dead. Right? Alive raises the alive. He quickened the Spirit by the Holy Spirit that he gave us after he died and rose again on the third day. And I like when Paul said, we not just stop there, but there were witnesses. Some are still alive. And guess what? You don't even refer to that today. Some are still alive. Amen? Look around you. Look to your left and to your right. Some of us are still alive. What? Just because we need to do what we need to do? No, we need to be sharing Jesus Christ in the lost and dying world. People are out there searching. People are out there still asking questions. And every time the door gets opened up, we take advantage of that opportunity. And it doesn't matter to me, because I tell you what, I guarantee you, when you talk to Paul, he's going to talk about Jesus with you. You know, people go, all you talk about is Jesus. That's what we got. That's what makes our life whole. That's what makes us complete. That's what excites us. The Holy Spirit empowers us to give us those things that we need to do what we need to do. And when you share with somebody, you say, God, well, you could have done, no, I can't do this on my own. It's only by the power of the Holy Spirit that he gave me, that he promised me when he ascended to the Father. I would not leave you orphans, but I'll send you another what? Comforter. How many of you lost in your sin when you got saved felt an overwhelming feeling of comfort? Say, I mean, I did. Nothing like it, is it? Now, we got a lot more believers in here. Did you raise your hands? Are you still kind of sleeping? Are you really here? You know me, I'm not afraid to pick on people. I don't, you know. Some people say, you know, pastors really shouldn't do that because they might not come back and visit. Well, the thing about it is they should, because we're giving them personal attention. That's the kind of God we have, you know? That's the kind of God we have, because prayer he does, it's the personal touch. He loved us so much, he died for us. Not only did he die, but he rose again on the third day. That should excite the dickens out of us in the body of Christ. But we wait till Resurrection Sunday to get pumped up and read scriptures like this. I was reading that over again, I'm like, wow. You know, it's like a brand new revelation again going through there. You know, you're reading scripture, you're preparing, all of a sudden you hit that one, and you're like, man, that's exciting stuff. That's exciting stuff. If not for this person wouldn't have got saved. This person wouldn't have got saved. This person wouldn't have got saved. It takes this life to touch this life, amen? And if I came to you as a zombie, like everybody seems to be worshiping nowadays, what if I came to you, I'm going to use you now, I'm sorry, I came to you with no teeth, holes in my skin, head falling off, and I want to talk to you about Jesus. I'm sure a lot of you would be standing there saying, yeah, I want to hear how you got to. No. Dead doesn't attract life, amen? But man, when you go to somebody and you just blow them out of the water, let me tell you what Christ did for me. Let me tell you how he transformed my life. When I read in the scriptures, it's just everything's coming true. Everything's coming true. And that person kind of look at you kind of foolish, like, ooh. You know, man, I'm drinking all that now. I don't feel that good. I wonder when people get tired of searching in the world for happiness, searching in the world to meet their needs, when they come to Jesus Christ to get those needs met. No worry. When's the last time you worried? Probably just this morning. Okay? I see more of people talking about worry than anything else. And you know what I'm driving us with? Philippians 4, what? 6 to 8. Be anxious for nothing. Don't worry about anything. And somebody, why do you use that? Because everyone has to use that. No one is exempt from worry or fret. We all get caught up in that. Don't worry about tomorrow. Worry about what we're going to eat. And the Bible says, worry, you know, don't worry about those things. I'll make provision for those things. Well, sometimes you've got to get into the presence of God. Well, you're not going to get into the presence of somebody who's dead, amen? You want to come into the presence of somebody that's alive, I'll hear you. Man, when we come into the presence of God, he's alive. In Jesus' name. You're not praying in a dead man's name. You're praying in a living person's name. And he's hearing you. He's taking you to the throne room. He's interceding on your behalf. Man, if that doesn't excite you alone, then you must enjoy being dead. Walk around with no teeth and holes in your skin. But it always amazes me when I get around somebody and they're unhappy where they're at. And you offer them another way. And they'll fight harder to accept, you know, to deny the truth than to accept the truth. And he asks them, why are you so unhappy all the time? Well, you know, my life is this, my life is that. Let me give you some life. Let me give you something. You know, I don't. And then you hear the stories of the church. That's the amazing thing to me. That's why we're so hard on the church sometimes, pastors up here banging on you guys, because you know something? Most lost people come back and you talk to them what they say. Well, such and such goes to church every Sunday, and I see no difference in him. Or Susie Bob goes to church every Sunday, and she's still trotting around with all the eyes. You know what I'm saying? What do we fix our eyes on? What we can see. How do we change that thinking? This is exactly right. Live our lives according to the Word of God and according to what Christ did in you. Continue to be that new creation in him. Old things are passed away, but what? All things become new. Wow. Why would you want to hang on to the old junk when you can get some new stuff? And we're people built on stuff. We are. We like stuff. Why don't we like new stuff from God? Can he give you something new every day? Every day he can give you something new. Every single day. He doesn't give it to us on our terms. He gives it to us on his terms. I love what Paul said here in verse 10. He said, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any one of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that was in me. Man, the world just seen the grace of God coming out of our lives. Why do you enjoy riding motorcycles so much? Because God allowed me to live another day of riding. That's a tool out there. Everything we have is a tool for Jesus Christ. Everything. How do you get those cuts? You earn them. You walk in the light of the Lord. You just don't get handed those things. People got to know that you belong to Jesus, not belong to some club. Okay, you belong to Jesus first, then you become part of it. It's just like the body of Christ. You belong to Jesus first, you become part of the body. Amen? And that's exciting. When you take put off the old, you put on the new. You couldn't alive in Jesus Christ. People need to walk in here and see a church that's on fire, a church that's alive in Jesus Christ. Every answer you give somebody ought to be coming right out of here. Don't sympathize for them. Pray for them. Pray with them. Speak out loud to them. Man, I got a Jesus that can meet your needs right now. Really, I don't believe in all that kind of junk. I'll tell you what, I'm going to pray for you. How about that? I've never seen anybody yet refuse to be prayed for. That's a start. That's a start. Every opportunity, everything we have, we've been given in Jesus Christ to use for His honor, His glory, and His praise. To show that He is living. To show that He is alive in us and everything. Because we go back to the Word of God, everything is His anyhow. Who are you? I belong to Jesus. Who's your wife? She belongs to Jesus. Then she's mine. You know, you do it the other way, huh? Yeah, she'd be mine, you know. You always do that. You always hang on that wife thing. Your friends are tougher. You don't hang on to them as much. You ever notice that? You don't even notice that you're switching gears a little bit. You don't even notice that girls don't play hard to get until they marry you. I always find that amusing. I'm like, I'm not blaming. I'm not going to blame. Until I get the married part. My wife says no more now than she ever did when we were dating. But you know, that's God just getting used to sometimes when you go to Him, He tells you no. You know, we don't like no, do we? No, we don't like no. No one likes no. But sometimes you got to do the no thing, don't we? God does the no thing. It's almost like don't go through that sign or else. What do we do sometimes? We go through the sign. God gives us warnings. God has given us everything that we need. Says His Word is alive and powerful. This is a living word. That's not a dead God. It's a live God. Living words in here to meet every need that you have, even the Marines. I used to think my drill instructor was really tough until I met Jesus. I'm like, man, he wouldn't do what he did. Now we talk about team and camaraderie and stuff like that. You know, they wouldn't do what he did. Most of us look at each other's flaws. What if Jesus looked at us like that? He doesn't. He doesn't. He looks beyond that. We spend too much time cleaning up, fixing up, and those kind of things instead of turning to the living God. Get that straight now and just share Him with you. But if you're like, no man could change me, nobody could change me, just Jesus Christ. So if He's changed you, use those tools that He's given you to share with the lost tonight. When someone calls and they're hurt, we share Jesus with them. Drive them nuts. I don't care. I don't get called an aggravator for nothing. I'm going to aggravate you with Jesus. That's all I have. That's all that's in me. I don't have anything else. I don't have a lot of money. I don't have anything, you know. But I do have Jesus. He'll meet all your needs according to what? His riches, glory, what? In Christ Jesus. But you have to wait. You have to be quiet. You have to come before Him. We don't like to wait. We don't like to wait. We can't wait till this day to come today. Resurrection Sunday. Man, I'm riding my motorcycle like, man, it's already over. That fast. Like, man, Lord, it goes by too fast. I'm like, God, just speaking my heart. He said, it doesn't have to end. See, that's what we do with it, don't we? We get excited on Christmas morning. Jesus was born. He's the greatest gift in the world. We're all excited. We're opening up gifts. The very next day, we're miserable. We're taking gifts back. We're fighting the crowds. We're doing all these kind of things. Also, we forgot whose birthday it was. That quick. Same thing with Resurrection Sunday. We serve a risen Savior. He did what He said He was going to do. For who? For us. For us. Hung on the cross, suffered, bled, died. On the third day, rose again for us. That is exciting stuff. That should be something that comes to your heart every single day. When you're feeling down and you're feeling mopey-dopey and slopey, you just got to think about, wait a minute, I serve a Savior that loved me in spite of me. I have no reason to be sloping, don't you know? But can you be happy all the time? I'm not saying that, I'm not happy all the time, but I don't stay unhappy long. I don't have the answer for everything, except you guide me in the Word of God. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say, rejoice. In who? Not Pastor Rand, in Jesus. If we spent the time before Him being pleasing to Him, we spend a lot less time pleasing each other. Again, because our thinking thing, if not for you, I don't have them. I got to remember that. If not for Christ saving me, I don't have you guys. You are a gift from God. That's how I have to treat you. You don't abuse a gift from somebody special. Your wife gives you a gift, what do you do with it? First time she asks for that gift set, what do? You get scared. The color goes out of your face. We remember Jesus' birthday, we remember everything else. You know, I forgot my wife's birthday one time. And that's not a good place to be. I thought my wife was really in the presence of the living God until I forgot her birthday. And see, in my mind, I thought I was doing it right. I remember our anniversary. Isn't that a good one? You remember the anniversary? Because you mind, stupid. That didn't work. My story is like 2 months afterwards, you know. She's all a mess. I'm like, honey, what's wrong? Don't ever tell me that either. I think you really need to pray. Go to God and say, Lord, do I dare ask my wife this question? And I think God's going to say, now's not the time. But being a man, what do you do? Well, I think you're wrong. Well, I was. And I pushed it. Honey, what's the matter with you? Did I do something? No, you didn't do nothing. Really? How's going to act like this? You forgot my birthday! And of course, you know, being a good Christian husband, I listen to God, but don't say nothing else. No, I couldn't do that. I'm like, really? Don't go over so good. Man, it's amazing how you get back in the presence of God as soon as you say something like that. It's like, Lord, save me again. Save me again. I'm glad you resurrected my life, but I'm getting ready to die here. But it's exciting the things that you learn. But the more you get in the Word of God, the more you honor Him and you just come before God being thankful every single day. Lord, thank you that you did what you did for me. I guess it's absolutely incredible to think that you were looking down from Calvary at me. You said, I'm dying for that one. I'm dying for that one. I always like the example I ever heard. There's only one person on the face of the earth Jesus would have went to the cross for that one. That's the thinking that we come to. When I think about Resurrection Sunday, it's not just about dressing up and getting fixed up and getting prettied up and stuff. It's coming before God, being grateful. Coming to a place that you're thankful, like, Lord, wow, you did that for me. I'm special, I'm honored, I'm privileged. Lord, now what is it you want me to do for you? Be like the prophet, so here am I, send me. Get to a place with God that He's done so much for you that you cannot wait to do something back for Him. And that's sharing your life. That's being available to that person that needs you when you don't want to be needed. You get them phone calls, and you see the ID thing, and it's like, the guy says, you need to, I'm not talking about you this time. Yeah, pastors deal with a lot of stuff. You get that call ID, you're going, And remember, I've shared with them many times when I've answered the phone, I've gotten my socks blessed off. Because if somebody it's neat when somebody comes and calls you, I just want to tell you what God has done in my life. It's like, oh, I need to hear that. Not just a pastor thing, just anybody. Let me tell you what Jesus has done for me. Man, I was doing this and that and the other thing. Man, I was getting my head caved in. I was getting beat up. Man, I repented. I turned back to God. And I said, Lord, you got to do something with me. Get me out of this funk. And man, you wouldn't believe what happened. We have heard stories like that. It's amazing. And that's not just for no reason. When someone tells you that, it does what? It should inspire you because God's speaking to you through that individual, man. It's amazing when someone's speaking to somebody, you're like, oh, that's great. And you're not hearing God speak to you at all. He's living. He speaks to other people's testimonies.
to you. But we don't listen to that. We don't. We kind of get caught up in our own stuff, and we miss everything God is sharing with us. Because why? Because we're already, again, like we're thinking of the answer for them already. Even when someone is sharing a blessing, what do we want to do? We want to out-bless them. Let me tell you what God did for me. That means, you know, it's good. I'm glad. I'm excited for you, brother. Let me tell you what God did for me. You're not hearing it. Just like some of these folks did not hear Paul. And that's what he said. For I delivered to you, first and foremost, that I've also received that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. That he was buried on the third day, raised again in accordance with what? The Scriptures. He appeared to Cephas, then he appeared to 500 more. Most of them are still alive today. Then he appeared to James, and then to the apostles. Last of all, one untimely born. Paul didn't even deserve. That's where his humility comes in. When I read that again, I'm like, man, Paul's still there. Man, I didn't deserve what I got. That's like Paul became what Paul became. What was he doing? He's persecuting the church. Some of you think, well, man, I can't serve the church. Look how bad off God has done all this kind of thing. You can use Paul, use anybody. Persecuting the church, dragging people to prison, putting them in. God knocking down his knees. Got his attention, revealed himself to him. That guy stood up, what? Changed, transformed. What did he do right away? Started preaching Jesus. Man, what a difference. Now, did he have a lot of knowledge of the word? No. He had a lot of education. But when he started sharing with people, let me tell you what Jesus did for me. Let me tell you what Jesus transformed my life. He took this miserable individual, knocked me down on the road, picked me up, put me on my feet. Man, I can't help but share Jesus with a lost and dying world. You read the rest of the epistles, God used Paul to write those things. He was hard on you sometimes, but he was what? Read Philippians. He doesn't want you to be down all the time. He wants you excited in the Lord. He wants you to see that God has a purpose for your life. You just need to get out of the way. You just need to receive. You need to shut up and listen sometimes. I know people like that word either. Because it's not about us. You've heard that set up here. And that just came out. It's not about us. It's not about me serving God. It's about Jesus working through me to serve other people. That's what it's about. It's not about us. We're never to draw the attention to us. You just heard what Paul said. It's not about it. The grace of God is in me. He encouraged, he built up, he exhorted everybody with what Jesus Christ did for him. But he rose on the third day. And he put the emphasis in that thing. But here's where some people get stuck. In verse 19, it said, and in Christ, we have hope in this life only. You hear that? If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are all people most to be pitied. Some people are still stuck here. Paul said for me to die is gain. See, in Christ, it's always gain. For me to die is gain. For me to live is Christ. You hear that? For me to die is gain. For me to live is Christ. Now, see, everybody has to act like some pastor over here jumping around and like a goofball, but you need to act like the believer that God created you to be. Everyone has a purpose and a plan. You have something in your life you can share with someone else to reach them. That's what Paul did. There's not an epistle written that doesn't reach others for Jesus Christ. It doesn't say, pray for that person, pray that they're healed, and their sins will be what? Forgiven them. Everything you take to the throne room. But we don't do that. We don't. I don't like being miserable. I don't. I don't like being when I'm miserable. God doesn't like being when I'm miserable. That's why you go right back here. Be anxious for nothing but everything. Through prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be known to God. And the peace of God that passes understanding. Some of us are in a total uproar because we're still trying to do it ourselves. Instead of giving it over to God, being humble before Him, saying, Lord, I can't do this. You need to help me through this. Hear that? That rhymed, didn't it? I can't do this. You need to help me through this. We don't know better than God, folks. We don't. Today's just not a day that we celebrate and get dressed up for, guys. Today's a day we should celebrate every single day. This day is about us in the sense that Jesus died on Friday, rose again today, to defeat death and the grave for us, to release us from the bonds of sin, to give us freedom. What? Freedom in Him. So you know the truth, and the truth will set you free. 1 John, turn to 1 John chapter 1. I'm going to close here, maybe. I'm sorry, it's one of the little Johns in the back. Somebody said, I'm not reading the same thing you're reading. Read back. Well, it says John, not the first John. It's one of the little ones. Oh, that one. Messes people up when you tell them there's a bunch of little Johns in the scripture, doesn't it? I like what John wrote here. He says, that which was from the beginning, which we heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands concerning the word of life, the word of life, the life was made manifest, and we seen it and testified to it and proclaimed to you eternal life. Man, it's that little bit of time with Jesus and John's got it right because it's eternal life. It's eternal life. God is the only one who can give you such a gift. Now, He's a saved God, right, to save people. Which was with the Father, was made manifest to us. That's talking about Jesus. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim to you also, that you may too have fellowship with us. That's what it's about. It's about sharing Jesus with them so you can be in right kind of fellowship with everyone else. See, we're in turmoil in the body of Christ, but we're not in the right kind of fellowship. The right kind of fellowship. So too many have fellowship with us, and indeed our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. But we are writing these things that what? Our joy may be complete. Another eyewitness. I'm like, why would you want to live any other way? Why would you want to live any other way? I can't imagine living any other way. I've tried the other ways. A lot of people in here have tried the other ways. How many of you want to go backwards? Well, I'm glad no hands are going up there. Nobody. You've been given an opportunity. God did not save you for anything, for nothing. He saved you to serve Him and to purpose with your life. So many people today, and we've said this before, what can I do? You share your life with somebody. Your life is a testimony. If you know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, your life is a testimony. When somebody asks you, why should I believe Jesus? Let me tell you what He's done for me. Let me tell you what I haven't gone without. I don't promise riches, I don't promise that you won't go hungry. You won't go without clothes. Your clothes might not look real good, but you're not going to go without them. You have a place to live, funky old car to drive. And He might even bless you with a Harley Davidson. Now, Karen will dispute me on that one. Because we got in a wreck with the van and I got money. I went right over and bought my Harley. Thank you, Lord. It's amazing what God can do with you when you give yourself over to Him. And it's not too late. Believers, it's not too late. We've done it our way long enough. Do we truly want the joy of the Lord in our lives? Or do we want to continue to do it the world's way or play with the world? You ever seen any Christian that straddled the line? Man, it feels kind of good here. It feels kind of good here. But my life is still a mess here. And it's like, well, you got to give up something. And then when you realize it, guess what? You're not giving up anything. See, that's where we got to come to a place in Christ. What are we giving up? That thing that made us miserable in the first place. Why in the world do we hang on to misery? We just kind of, it's like, we got to torture ourselves a little bit. That's not what God wants us to be. He wants us to move on. He wants us to use those things in our life to reach others for Jesus Christ. So they can experience the same life-giving joy that we've been given. We're selfish as believers. We want to pick the time, choose the way, how we do it, and all these kind of things. But God just puts something in your life, and you're talking to somebody about those, make anything what? And it comes about Jesus, it just got to come in there. It just has to come in there. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Not being 6'6", 6'4", big guy, that's not our strength. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Because we're in times right now where everybody wants us defeated. The devil wants us defeated. He wants our families torn apart. He's doing that kind of, he's winning the battle in the body of Christ. Pastors are falling left and right. Because they're forgetting what this thing's about. If you're getting left right, you never want to get in a place again, ever. Ever. See, we stand on the Word of God, but sometimes we test the Word of God, and we go against the Word of God, and we experience some horrible bad things, and God still restores us back where we need to be, he's like, man, I ain't going back. I ain't going back there. But God does those things to let you learn so what you can share with someone else. There's pastors out there struggling. Their church doesn't have a clue because they're not paying attention. Because you know why? Because their church is so into themselves. If you know that his job is to take care of all their needs, that you're just sitting out there and no one's praying for the pastor. Pastor's got it down, man. He's really close to God, man. What can anybody do to him? He said, man, pastor, I got all this stuff I need you to take care of. But that's not it. The Bible says, pray unceasingly. Lift up your leaders. Lift up your church. Lift up your friends. Lift up your family. You're not happy where someone's at. They're not happy where they're at. And they don't kind of like what you're doing. You still, what do? You take them to the throne room. See, we kind of give up. We get discouraged. I didn't raise them that way. We get stuck in that mode as parents, don't we? I didn't raise them that way. Let them learn. Well, you know, sometimes God straightens that out too. Share that, and I've got one more closing. We had a son-in-law we hated, disliked terribly. And my daughter divorced. Terribly disliked that guy. Now, you've heard us say it, but I tell you, I prayed many times that God, give me the liberty to knock his head in. And it never happened. You know, one day I came in, and Karen's weeping, and she said, you know, and our house was in a mess. Our house was in a mess. We kept coming in. Her and I are fighting. We're fighting with our daughter. All this stuff was going on. The devil's just having a heyday. And I walked in one day, God, Karen's weeping. She said, we've got to pray for him. And I'm like, are you kidding me? I prayed for him. Yeah, I prayed for him. Lord, throw him under the bus for our own 5 or 6 times. Now, here's the problem. Guess what? He's lost his goat. He's out there doing his thing. He's getting away with all kinds of things. We're a mess. We're miserable. We have the power of God to make a difference. And we put Satan in control of our house, our lives. It's not that we start praying for him, that God started doing something in our daughter's life. Not necessarily his. But it's amazing. We went to him wanting to take me to court, to him wanting to take my daughter out for dinner and make a peace. Should have had a BA. See, you learn those things the hard way sometimes. Because you think sometimes it's all right, Lord. They've hurt my family. I need to hurt them back. No place in Scripture are you given that privilege to do. No place. Guess what that person deserves? Jesus. Just like we deserve Jesus. Why is they any different? You see what I'm saying? Man, we're real quick. We're real quick to determine who can get in and who can't. That's not the Word of God. But you know something? God will let you go through what you go through to teach you a lesson, humble you, bring you down, and put you in a place that you need to be. Pray for your enemies. Bless them to curse you. Wow. Now, I'm not saying you can't defend yourself, but I'm just here's what I am saying. You just can't go out and pound on people. You just can't do that. That's not God. But you got to pray for them. And I'll tell you what, when you come to a place when you pray for that person you least care about, now you know you're in fellowship. Now you know you're right where the resurrected Lord wants you to be. He wants you to be alive. He wants you to be excited. He wants you to feel his presence and his joy. If you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you're miserable. I don't understand that. But sometimes you've got to go through what you've got to go through. But don't leave this place without Christ. And I'm going to tell you something. It will change your lives. It'll make you somebody that you can never possibly be. Believer, you're struggling, you're dealing with some things, give it to God. Give it to God. Bring it to this altar. Give it to God. But when you give it to him, leave it with him. Don't pick it back up. Come to the throne of grace to receive what? Grace and mercy in time of need. Leave it there. Get up and allow God to use you in a great way. Make a difference today. Resurrection Sunday doesn't end today. It begins today. Are you resurrected? But you're still part of the walking dead. We got a lot of dead believers walking around out there. A lot of miserable believers walking around. That's not where God wants you to be. Not at all. People aren't attracted to misery. They truly aren't. I don't care what you say. They're not attracted to miserable people. People are looking for a way to find some kind of joy and satisfaction in their lives. Don't they deserve to have the same satisfaction that you got? Yes, they do. Yes, they do. So get out of your way, put God back into place, and doing what he'd have you to do, the way he'd have you to do it. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. You've been given this breath in your body this day. That means God's given you one more day to reach one more person. One more. That one's going to drive you guys nuts, I know it, but I'm telling you that. The angels rejoice over one sinner that comes to repentance. One. Man, if we get one a week, heaven's coming apart. That's one. But we got to get the one. We got to get the one. And that means putting Jesus Christ first in our lives to quicken our spirits to make us alive because we serve a risen Savior. Let's pray. Father, we just come before you, Lord. We thank you. We praise you. We bless you. And Father, I just pray the Holy Spirit would move through this place to quicken spirits. Father, if people are truly saved, truly washed in your blood, Father, set them free from anything that's holding them captive. Father, set them free today. Father, use them as your instruments. Father, to turn the world upside down. It's not too late. It's not too late. You don't have to be fancy. You don't have to be smart, Lord. Just tell them that. You don't choose the wise things of this world to do your work. You choose the foolish things of this world. Sometimes we think we've not done. We're created in your image. We're your children. We thank you for that. Father, speak to those people that need you most right now. Speak to that one, Lord, that's struggling, that's battling. That, Father, the only answers you're going to get is you're going to come directly from you. But, Father, they need to come into that relationship with you. Father, change us, transform us, excite us. Father, just that this day won't pass as just another holiday. But, Father, a special day to jumpstart us every day. Speak to the hearts in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.